Well, this may be the best venue, you know. Now, I have to tell you, I have two reactions. First of all, I'm an Army brat. My dad spent 27 years in the infantry. And so I grew up as a kid around systems like this, although I think this is a Pershing, which was we built right at the end of World War II and was our first genuinely modern tank, replacing the Sherman. And so from an Army brat standpoint, this brings back lots of memories. Now, from a political standpoint, I look at this tank lovingly because I remember Michael Dukakis. And it's just a reminder that governors of Massachusetts don't always make good presidential candidates. Now, before I get started, and I want to say briefly some things about the two great people who introduced me. There's somebody else I want to have just chat for a minute. We need to get him a microphone. You have a favorite son from right here at home. I was thrilled. He had a call a while back, and he said, you know, it's so important that a Reagan conservative win that he wanted to come and volunteer and spend virtually full time just helping us. And that's Senator Bob Smith. And I just want to ask Bob, come on up for a minute. Do we have a microphone? There you go. Bob, just take a minute to talk to the hometown folks.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. You know, this is his show, and I just want to say thank you for coming, and thank you for all coming to see Speaker Gingrich. You know, in 1984, when I was elected, I walked into the Congress, didn't really know where the bathroom was, and here's a congressman from Georgia who came over. He says, before you really get involved with all the minutiae that happens here, are you content to be in the majority, in the minority here, and fighting this liberal majority of Democrats, or do you really want to? You really want to take the bull by the horns and take control? And I said, I think the answer is obvious. He said, come on. And we met about 10 of us in a closet called the Conservative Opportunity Society in the Capitol, and it's true. And we plotted the revolution, but it's not finished. And the reason why I left the sunny area of Key Largo to be up here in the colds of New Hampshire is because I believe in this man. We need him so desperately right now. And I can't tell you, I couldn't even put into words how much I mean that. He and his wife, Calista, have produced this movie about Ronald Reagan. If you saw that movie and you realize all of Reagan's dreams, all the things that he wanted to do, we helped him in the House and in the Senate in those days when Reagan was there, thanks to Newt. We'd probably still be in minority were it not for him. And now, we need to finish that revolution to honor President Reagan. This man can do it. He has the philosophy. He has the conservative principles and values. He is a Reagan conservative through and through. Let's finish the revolution, and let's elect Newt Gingrich. Please elect Newt Gingrich right here on next Tuesday. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, Bob.
Welcome to you.
Thank you. So before I get started, how many of you are either veterans or families of veterans? Virtually all of you. I just think we owe you a real debt of gratitude, and I want to say thank you for coming to this veterans rally, because without your willingness to risk everything, you know, when you swear the oath entering the armed services, you're basically signing over your life to the commander-in-chief. I'm wearing, this is the flag that George Washington flew at Valley Forge in front of his command headquarters. This is the flag of the commander-in-chief of the American Army. And when they met in Philadelphia, he presided over the Constitutional Convention. So when they wrote into the Constitution, the president is the commander-in-chief, they knew what they meant. He wasn't an advisor-in-chief, he wasn't a talker-in-chief, he wasn't a politician-in-chief. She bears the ultimate moral responsibility for the defense of the United States and the defeat of our enemies. That's how real this is. And when you signed up, you gave that commander-in-chief control over your life. And because you did that, we are today still a free nation. And without our veterans, we would not today be a free nation. So I'm thrilled to be here. I thank you. Two great folks who introduced me. Speaker O'Brien is the model of what we need.
Yes.
What he and his team, and he's very good at always reminding you that it's the team. But what he and the team did, when they confronted a budget deficit, they did one of the, I'm going to try to get every state to do this in the federal government. They did one of the smartest things I've heard. My jaw dropped when he told me. They started by having the Ways and Means Committee report how much money was coming in. They then said, we can pass any budget up to that amount. Now, as you know, normally what politicians do is they figure out how much they want to spend. Then that leaves them with a shortfall, so they figure out how much they have to take away from you. And they ended up cutting 18% out of the New Hampshire-based expenditures and 11% if you count federal funding. Now, I don't know of any state that had a more courageous and more direct effort to protect the taxpayer. They protected the average family in New Hampshire from $3,000 in additional taxes. And they did it the old-fashioned way. They had to set priorities, cut out waste, make decisions, everything that U.S. Congress and the President have refused to do. And one of the reasons I'm campaigning is I would like to make Washington more like New Hampshire, whereas the left would like to make New Hampshire more like Washington. And that's a very easy way to think of the difference. It's also a huge difference between Speaker O'Brien and his team, who represent a Tea Party, conservative, small government, low tax movement, and Governor Romney, who campaigned a no tax increase in 2002 and passed a $730 million tax increases, most of them in the form of fees, which were, by the way, mandatory. Now, the two that are most amazing is there was a tax on people who were blind, which is a little hard to imagine, but true. And the other was a tax on gun ownership. He quadrupled the cost of owning a gun, so you had to register guns in Massachusetts, and you then had to pay $100 per gun every year under Romney. So it's a sort of a tax increase on the Second Amendment right, in my judgment. So the difference between raising taxes because you don't have the courage to cut government and cutting government because you refuse to raise taxes, I think is a really dramatic difference. Second, I'm really glad to have Bud McFarland here. I worked with Bud when he was National Security Advisor. He did a great job. One of the reasons he did a great job is, unlike a lot of the politicians who end up in Washington, Bud came out of a military background, and he actually thought his job was to help the president be effective, not maneuver around the president. And because he had in Ronald Reagan a president who knew what he intended to do, president who was calmly and methodically determined to defeat the Soviet Empire, Bud really played a decisive role in one of the most important administrations we've had, because Reagan actually had a clear vision. When I talk about being a Reagan conservative, it's based on, I first met Reagan in 74. I campaigned in 79-80, helped develop supply-side economics with Jack Kemp and Art Laffer and Larry Kudlow and others. And then I worked with the Reagan administration for 8 years. It's a very simple model. Reagan set out to accomplish three things. Because he understood something really important about leadership. Lions cannot afford to hunt chipmunks. Because even if they catch them, they starve to death. And so lions have to hunt zebra and antelope. And Reagan got up every morning and he said, well, what are my antelope? And there were three. Rebuild the American economy. And he had a clear strategy I'll talk about in a minute. Renew American civic culture so we were proud to be American. Defeat the Soviet Empire. Well, these are pretty big. He would then go in the Oval Office about 10 in the morning, and chipmunks would run in. Now, the federal government grows $10 billion chipmunks. I mean, these are big chipmunks. And Reagan would listen. I'm sure Bud recognizes this. Reagan would listen patiently, because he was a very disciplined, positive person. And he would say, you are a terrific chipmunk. have you met Jim Baker? And Jim Baker, the president's chief of staff, became the largest chipmunk collector on the planet. And I really learned a lot about leadership from this, because the news media completely misunderstood it. It wasn't that Reagan was disengaged. It was that Reagan had two boxes in his head. He had a chipmunk box, which was pat him on the head and get rid of him. And he had an antelope box, which is get it done. Now, I'm going to show you the difference here for a second. This is a great study with Bud here. This is a great study in real leadership. So Reagan wants to send a signal. I mean, he got down into the weeds if the weeds involved the big issues. Secretary of State George Shultz told me this story. Reagan had gone to Berlin as governor in 1967. And he said, that wall sure is ugly. They ought to tear it down.
I was there.
You were there. Pretty good throw.
Berlin, 65 to 68.
There you go. So he was there. And the wall was ugly, and they should have torn it down. 20 years later, Reagan has been reelected president, carried 49 states. He's going to go back to Berlin, and he has this line he wants to deliver. Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. Now, the State Department hated the line. They thought it made Gorbachev feel bad. It didn't sound presidential, and it wasn't going to happen. So the speech goes from the White House over to State Department, and the State Department editor takes out the line. Goes back to the White House. Reagan personally writes in. Goes back over to the State Department. They take out the line. This is Secretary Shultz to me. Goes back to the White House. Reagan calls Secretary of State. Says, Georgie, you need to tell your editor, I am the president, they aren't. The line stays in. Now, what's amazing is they get to Berlin. That morning, before he goes to give the speech, there are still senior advisors saying to him, please don't give this line. It's not going to happen. The wall's going to be there for 30 more years. You're going to look foolish. Now, it's one of the greatest lines of his presidency, and the wall fell in 2 years. And that's what real leadership is. Real leadership understands the principles that matter, the correct vision of the future, and the courage to impose your will when every timid person around you is scared to death that what you're about to do is foolish, because as a leader, you believe in doing what's right no matter what the staff thinks. And that's the key. And that's why I think a bold Reagan conservative can defeat Barack Obama decisively, whereas I think that a timid Massachusetts moderate will actually have a much harder time, because what you want to have, when you're facing an opponent with $1 billion, the support of the elite news media and the power of the White House, you want to create a big gap. So I'm for American energy, he's against it. I'm for paychecks, he's for food stamps. I'm for lower taxes, he's for higher taxes. I'm for helping every American create jobs, he's for class warfare to divide the country. You want the gap to be this big, because then most of his $1 billion falls in the middle. Now, we saw this with Reagan. Reagan took on Carter. Carter was sort of a milder version of Obama. Equally bad performance, but not as wildly radical. And Reagan really was able to draw such a vivid comparison that it made a huge difference. And so no matter what Carter did in the end, the comparison stuck. That's why Reagan, in the only time they debated, came up with, there you go again. And people knew exactly what he was saying. Carter would make some wild charge, and Reagan would just say, there you go again, people would laugh, and they got it. So let me talk about two issues that relate a great deal to veterans and to New Hampshire. First, I want to talk about the Northern Pass. You have my commitment that I will do everything I can to ensure that the only way that happens is if it is buried underground along state right-of-way. We have the technology today that we do not have to choose between delivering electricity to Boston and the tourist industry and the beauty of northern New Hampshire. We can insist on a technologically advanced solution, which, by the way, the state could make money from by actually leasing part of the right-of-way, so you also don't have to get into eminent domain, and you don't have to go into the taking of private property. And I would just suggest to you that that allows us to have a win-win solution that enables Quebec electricity to arrive in the big city without having run over everybody in between. And I think there's no reason to assume that in America, everybody in between needs to get run over just so that big cities and big businesses can get what they want. Second, I think it is profoundly wrong that in midwinter, veterans have to go all the way to Boston to get health care. And I'm committed to three things that I want you to know about for veterans in New Hampshire. First, I'm committed to reopening the Manchester Hospital is a full-service facility, not just an outpatient clinic. Second, I am committed to developing a very sophisticated clinic in the North Country that uses telemedicine so you can get a very high percentage of all your diagnostics and all your treatments done without ever having to go even as far away as Manchester. And third, I'm committed to an effective program that enables you, if you prefer, to use your local doctor and your local hospital so you don't even have to travel to the clinic. So it seems to me, and I say this as the son of a 27-year career soldier and somebody who really values military families and veterans' families and knows what you have to go to, it just seems to me all you ever have to do to explain this is get somebody off the congressional committee in late January, early February, to come to northern New Hampshire, put them in a car, and let them try to get to Boston. And if you pick the right week with the right blizzard, they'll begin to get the idea, okay? And then if they hit three moose on the way, they will thoroughly understand why it's the wrong thing. So, anyway. Now, let me talk just very briefly about jobs and the economy and where we are, because this is a big deal. And let me draw a historical comparison, because I don't say much that's theoretical. I mean, I'm a history teacher by background, and I try to use facts, and I try to use history. Last month, we created 200,000 jobs, and the Obama administration is dancing in the streets, and this is really terrific, and I have to admit, compared to some of the months they've had, 200,000 beat nothing. But here's what we have to remember. In August of 1983, with Reagan, we created 1,300,000 jobs in 1 month, six times the number. Now, why does that matter? You have a real crisis in Europe that is still sitting there with the euro decaying and the European banks decaying. You have the potential for a real crisis in the Middle East with the Iranians practicing closing the Straits of Hormuz, and the Straits of Hormuz have one out of every six barrels of oil in the world go through it. You could, if either of those happens next spring, this coming spring, you could see the entire world tilt into a much deeper recession. The only engine big enough to pull the world economy is the United States. We're still one-fourth of the world economy. When we grow, the sheer momentum of our growth changes things. Now, this is one of the things that, frankly, is why I'm running for president. Because we know how to do this. I mean, this is one of those things where the academic left and the news media left and the political left is just so dense that you wonder, I mean, what happened to them? It's as though they had a cookbook that said, to get a hard egg, you put it in the freezer. Now, it's true. If you want to test this sometime, the young people who are here might want to go home and try this out as an experiment, you know. You put an egg in a freezer for a couple days, and it will, in fact, become hard. It's just that when you go to a restaurant and you say, hi, I'd like a hard egg, if they brought you out a frozen egg, you would think they were nuts. And let me give you an example. Reagan had five principles for economic growth. Strong money. He wanted a sound dollar. Lower taxes to incentivize people to go work and go invest. Less regulation, so people could focus on entrepreneurship, not taking care of government red tape. American energy, and and praising the people who create jobs. Now, what's the Obama model? Reagan's for sound money. Bernanke and Obama are for inflation. I mean, the amount of money they're printing right now, in the long run, they're just storing up for us a wave of inflation on a historic scale. Remember, under Carter, it got to be 13% inflation and 22% interest rates. Okay? So, opposite. Reagan, lower taxes. Obama, higher taxes. Reagan, less red tape. Obama, more power to EPA, OSHA, you name it. Reagan, more American energy. Obama, anti-American energy. Reagan, I love people who create jobs. I want to praise small business owners. I want to praise people who go to work. Obama, let's start class warfare and attack everybody who's successful. And is it any wonder that you have this gap? So, I've grown from the Reagan model. I helped develop it in the 70s. I helped implement it in the 80s. By the way, it was a bipartisan model. Tip O'Neill was Speaker of the House. If we were going to pass the Reagan program, we had to get one out of every three Democrats to vote for it. And we did. Because we reached out to everybody. We tried to develop an American program, not just a Republican program. So, I get to be Speaker. There were two tax increases after Reagan. The economy had slowed down. I pulled out the same cookbook. We reformed welfare. Two out of three people went to work or went to school. We passed the first tax cut in 16 years, largest capital gains tax cut in history. We created 11 million new jobs in 4 years. Unemployment dropped to 4.2%. And here's one of the keys. If you take somebody off of welfare, off of unemployment, off of food stamps, off of Medicaid, off of public housing, and you put them to work taking care of their family and paying their bills and paying taxes, you raise the revenue of the government without raising taxes, and you reduce the spending. So Clinton and I were able to hammer out four consecutive balanced budgets, paid off $405 billion of debt. It's the only time in your lifetime you've had four consecutive balanced budgets. This is part of why Speaker O'Brien and I identify with each other, because we are both speakers who believe in balanced budgets. Now, in that context, what would you do today? Well, I'm for sound money. I would fire Bernanke, shrink the role of the Fed. And I would focus the Fed on a stable dollar. Second, taxes. Zero capital gains tax so that money pours in the United States. A 12.5% corporate tax rate, which will free up $700 billion in profits from overseas, will allow American companies to compete on a fair playing field. And ironically, for our liberal friends, at 12.5%, General Electric will actually pay taxes. Yeah. 100% expensing. One of the things people don't realize about New Hampshire is how much precision manufacturing there is up here. When you think about it, what you want to do is have 100% expensing, which means whether you're a factory or a farmer or a doctor or a business, if you buy new equipment, you write it off in 1 year. And the goal is simple. We want American workers to be the best equipped workers in the world with the greatest productivity. It is the only way to have a high value job competing with China and India. Now, if you're going to do that on the equipment side, I would also modernize the unemployment compensation program by having a training requirement attached to it. So if you need unemployment compensation, you have to sign up for a business training course to learn a new skill while we're paying you, but we will never again pay somebody 99 weeks for doing nothing. Two other tax provisions. We would abolish the death tax permanently because it is a destructive tax, which is immoral. And at a personal tax level, we'd give you an option. You can keep the current deductions, the current red tape, the current bookkeeping, or you could have an optional 15% flat tax in the Hong Kong tradition. You fill in one page. This is what I earned. This is the number of dependents. Here's my tax. The fact is, if you do that, then people have a choice. Hong Kong's done this for 40 years. We're not taking anybody's deductions away. We're giving you the choice of simplicity versus complexity. You get to choose which is better for you. That's a tax cut. Now you come to regulatory. Pretty straightforward. You want to fix this country quickly? I would ask the brand new Congress on January 3rd, 2013, to stay in session. And I would ask them before the inaugural to repeal Obamacare, it is the biggest job-killing component of regulatory behavior right now. Second, I would ask them to repeal the Dodd-Frank bill, which is killing small banks. Dodd-Frank kills small banks, cripples small business, and drives down the price of housing. Third, I'd ask them to repeal Sarbanes-Oxley, which has added paperwork and gained nothing for the country. I'd like all three of those done before January 20th, so when I'm sworn in, they can bring them in, and in the first 24 hours, we can sign the repeal of all three and get to work in a positive way. I would also, by the way, on the inaugural, have a series of executive orders about 2 hours after the inaugural address, the first of which would abolish all of the White House czars as of that moment. Now, other regulatory reform. We should replace the Environmental Protection Agency with a brand new Environmental Solutions Agency. We should not rehire any of the radicals currently trying to destroy the American economy. Everywhere I go, municipalities tell me how they're being dictated to by Washington bureaucrats who have never visited their town, have no idea about reality, have no concern about the budget, and simply issue Washington dictates that are destructive. And as all of you know, the EPA is the largest job-killing agency in the federal government. Now, I would also go to a 21st Century Food and Drug Administration on a very simple model. We want the FDA in the laboratory understanding the new science, and we want them to accelerate getting it to the patient, not block it. And that will change everything. It'll create hundreds of thousands of high-value-added jobs, allowing us to dominate the world health market, which is the biggest market in the emerging world, and it will enable us to get to patients better ways of saving their lives faster at lower cost. And so the duty of the FDA, literally to turn it upside down, it is today an obstruction to bringing new science to patients, and it is stunningly expensive, and it is guaranteeing that the breakthroughs are going to occur in China or India, because our lab scientists are going to go overseas to develop their products. They're not going to try to work through the FDA, so we have to fundamentally overhaul it. Those are examples. That's regulatory. Now let's talk about energy. I have a very simple model. I am for every form of American energy. And it's a very simple principle. I want America not just to be energy independent. I want us to have a surplus, so if something happens to the Straits of Hormuz, we can step in, and we can surge our productivity, and we can help make sure the world avoids a depression. And I want to get to a point where no American president ever again bows to a Saudi king, period. Now, I have to say, as a two-tiered venue, this is one of the cooler places we've ever done one of these in. I actually like this a lot. Now, two last examples on energy. President goes to Brazil. President has blocked development of American energy offshore. He has totally messed up Louisiana. His people clearly have no idea how the world works. When they put a moratorium in Louisiana against the advice of their technical experts, who told him it was the dumbest thing you could do, and I think the White House literally did not know that these huge ocean drilling rigs move. These are very expensive pieces of capital. And they're not going to sit around for 6 months or a year to be political exhibits for some totally demagogic politician. So the first one that left went to Egypt. And it took $80,000 a year jobs with it. Plus, when they drill oil, the government gets royalties. It's a major source of revenue. But the second one was perfect. The company that moved had a CEO who obviously was tough. And he issued the following statement. because of political instability in the United States, we are now going to develop off of the Congo. Now, I just want you to think about the fact that under Obama, we are less stable than the Congo. I mean, this is not easy. So in the middle of having stopped American oil and gas development, the president goes to Brazil. And he says, I really want to be, I want to thank you and congratulate you for developing offshore oil and gas. I am proud that we were able to guarantee $2 billion of equipment purchases, largely from a company owned by George Soros. And then he said this most amazing thing. He said, I want America to be your best customer. I thought to myself, this guy really doesn't get it. We don't hire presidents to be foreign purchasing agents. I mean, the Obama model is to borrow from the Chinese to buy from the Brazilians. It doesn't work. We hire an American president to be a salesman for American goods and services worldwide to create jobs in the U.S. selling overseas. Finally, you have the spectacle of the XL Keystone Pipeline. Now, let me just say up front. It's one thing if a White House can't play chess. It's another thing if a White House can't play checkers. But if a White House can't play tic-tac-toe, and let me explain why I use this analogy. I mean, this is one of the dumbest things I've ever seen. So the president has this dilemma, because of course he's in total reelection mode. He doesn't care about being president. He cares about being reelected. So he's actually not going to do much presidential stuff because that's all so boring, whereas giving speeches is so much fun. And so he has this really big dilemma. The San Francisco environmental extremists hate Canadian oil. The construction workers union wants to build a pipeline because it's 20 to 50,000 American jobs. Well, he doesn't want the union mad at him, and he doesn't want the environmentalists mad at him. So he thinks, being quite clever, I'll postpone the decision till 2013. Now, Prime Minister Harper is a conservative who's pro-American, but he's also the Canadian Prime Minister. So he says, you know, if the United States doesn't want to make a decision, I'm going to talk to the Chinese about paying for a pipeline, which is more expensive, over the Rockies to Vancouver. The ideal pipeline comes straight down. It's easy to build. It's flat. We have been building pipelines for well over 100 years. We know how to do this. It should go from Canada to Houston. Houston is the biggest petrochemical complex in the world. So you'd make money building the pipeline. You'd make money running the pipeline. You'd make money processing the oil for the next 30 to 50 years. You'd make money in the port of Houston and Galveston shipping the oil. It's a terrific win for America and Canada. But Harper says, look, if you guys are going to mess around and be totally unreliable, I'll just go to work with the Chinese and we'll build an all-Canada pipeline. Now, if you had said to me 3 years ago, the United States could have a president so incompetent that a Canadian-Chinese partnership made more sense than a Canadian-American partnership, I would have thought it inconceivable. But I'd underestimated how self-destructive Barack Obama is. So that's where we happen to be. The last point, of course, is I like people who create jobs. I am willing to be pro people who create jobs, whether they're small business jobs, they're self-employed jobs, they're entrepreneurs, they're inventors. What has made America great for our whole history has been the work ethic expressed in creativity and entrepreneurship. And so the gap between us and Obama is that big. I need your help Tuesday. I need your help from now to Tuesday talking to your many friends. I do think there is an enormous gap between somebody who is a bold Reagan conservative and somebody who is a timid Massachusetts moderate. I think it's big. I think it makes it very different in terms of how you would compete with Obama. I want you to know that with your help, if I become the nominee, I will challenge President Obama to 7 3-hour debates in the Lincoln-Douglas tradition, with a timekeeper and no moderator. I will agree in advance that he can use a teleprompter. After all, if you had to defend Obamacare, wouldn't you want to use a teleprompter? And I think with your help, we can win a decisive victory for America. We can make this one of the most important elections in American history. We can do what I helped Reagan do in 80 and what we did in 1994, which is show a clear, bold distinction around which we can rally the vast majority of Americans of all backgrounds. And as a result, in January of 2013, we can aggressively put this country back on the right track. And with your help, that's what I'll do. Questions? I think we have a couple of microphones, right? We have one there. We have another mic over this way, or just one mic? Yeah, we have one here. Okay. How about the gentleman standing way back there? And then we'll come to somebody over here. We'll go back and forth.
Thank you for coming to Wolfeboro. How big are your coattails? Nothing personal.
Oh, well, look, when we designed the 80 campaign, I helped chair the first Capital Steps event in history. Reagan came, it was a big risk. David Broder wrote about it in September of 1980. Reagan came and stood in the Capitol steps with every House and Senate candidate. We pledged five specific things. We won six U.S. Senate races by a combined margin of 75,000 votes. We shocked Washington because we took the Senate. We picked up 33 House seats as well as winning the presidency. So that was, it was a team victory. In 1994, we ran a team campaign, 350 candidates signed on to the contract with America. We had the largest one-party increase in American history, 9 million additional votes for the Republicans over 1990, a million fewer votes for the Democrats. So I think it's pretty fair to say I know how to design sweeps that are team victories. My goal as the nominee would be to carry the Senate by a big margin, to strengthen the House, to do it on an agenda that if you go to newt.org, there's a 21st century contract with America. And I think it's not so much having coattails, it is building a team where the entire team wins as a team. And my goal would be to make sure that we actually had the ability to pass what we're talking about by having elected an entire team committed to it. Okay? Good. Over here. Yes, fine.
Mr. Speaker, as chief executive, until you could get the EPA shut down and Department of Education shut down, would you simply order the doors closed so they couldn't get in there and continue messing things up?
I'm not sure I technically have quite that level of authority, but I could probably order them to re-review every single proposed regulation and keep them in rope-a-doping for a good long while we finish solving it. Okay. See, where is our microphone person? There you go.
Last night, Newt, I was down in Tilton, and your opponent, I asked him specifically how he felt about veterans. He did ask, are there any veterans? There was just a smattering of us there, hardly anything, which surprised me. And then I said, how do you feel? I said, how I feel about when you talk about cutting this, cutting that, as he was going on. I said, I worry about my veterans' benefits up there at White River Junction is where I go, because I live further north. And he said, I'm all for the military. He dodged the question. And then I asked him, and I said, I haven't read anything about Second Amendment with you either. And he goes, oh, I'm all for the Second Amendment. And we know his record down in Massachusetts. And one final other thing, a comment. Back in 1995 at Mackey Loeb's, I have a picture of you and me. Would you sign it?
Sure. Tell me your first name.
Slim. Remember that?
Yeah, just
before you got on the helicopter.
That's great. Well, I hate to say this, Slim, but no one has ever called me Slim, so it's a... I'm writing this to you with great admiration.
Thank you.
All right. There's a lady right here.
Mr. Speaker, thank you for being here. And listening to you, it's like a breath of fresh air. You know, I think so many people feel that, you know, we need a leader. We need leadership. Anyway, North Korea has the largest military in the world. China right behind it. Now our present administration, I don't even want to call him Mr. President, but he wants to cut our military. What are your feelings about that?
Well, I think when you elect a Sololinsky radical, you should expect that he'll behave like a Sololinsky radical. I mean, this is a guy who doesn't believe we have any enemies, worries about why America is not a better country than it could, you know. I mean, just listen to his speeches. He goes around the world apologizing for the U.S. He thinks we're the problem, you know. And my only advice is we have to defeat him. I mean, this guy is totally wrong. Come back this way. Just turn right in the front. We'll keep going around. Yes, sir.
There's a bunch of us here that are getting checks every month from Social Security. You have in your legislative proposal to save Social Security. What is your plan?
Okay. My plan for saving Social Security is two parts. And by the way, my mother-in-law depends on Social Security as her primary source of retirement income. So I'm very sensitive to this issue. And she pays a great deal of attention and emails me regularly to ensure that I not forget this. I'd say a couple things. One, I think we should take Social Security off budget. It was off budget until Lyndon Johnson combined it into a unified budget. He did it to use the Social Security surplus to hide the deficit. The reason I would take it off budget is what Obama did in July was totally unconscionable. He twice threatened people and said, I may not be able to send you your Social Security check. There is $2.4 trillion sitting in the trust fund. There is no excuse for any politician threatening anybody who's currently on Social Security because the money is there, the money's been paid for, and we ought to say to the politicians, keep your hands off Social Security. And so I would move to take it off budget. And I would provide that in the case of a debt ceiling problem, it was the second item paid after interest. You have to pay interest in the debt because it's in the Constitution. But it's the second item paid before anything else, just so people can relax. I mean, to say to people, I had a guy walk up to me at a hospital in southern New Hampshire back months ago who said that his 87-year-old father was really worried that he was going to lose his Social Security check. Now, for politicians to scare people of that age is just, I think, disgusting. And so I think let's take it away from them, make it automatic, put it over here, keep the trust fund safe, and not have a touch. Now, that's for your generation, and frankly, for your children. For your grandchildren, we have a proposal to allow them, the young people who are here, to allow them the right to choose, not force them to choose, allow them the right to choose a personal Social Security savings account. Now, this is not a theory. Galveston, Texas has this model. Chile, as a country, has this model. The principal group in Des Moines, Iowa, actually runs part of the Chilean system. And what does it mean? That means when you first go to work, your part of the Social Security tax would go into a savings account that would be yours. No politician can touch it. For your entire work, let's say you started with a part-time job at 16. That means that for 50 years or more, it's building up compound interest. In the Chilean and Galveston experience, the average retiree gets 2 to 3 times as much money as you get from Social Security. Now, both of them have a provision that says if you ever fall below the actual Social Security number, the government will make up the difference. So it's, you have a safety net. In 30 years, no one has gotten a check in Chile. All of them have been above the Social Security line. Now, what does it do? First of all, it means that you increase your estate, because instead of just transferring money back and forth, you're actually building up your money into an estate. So if anything happens to you, your family now has your estate. And there's an economist at Harvard who was the chair of Ronald Reagan's Council of Economic Advisors, Martin Feldstein, who estimates that you eliminate 50% of the inequality of wealth over a generation. Because every single American worker becomes an investor, they all end up having an estate. And all of a sudden, you've changed the whole fabric of American society. This is particularly important for African American males who have shorter, on average, have a shorter lifespan and actually get back less from Social Security than any other group. So you really dramatically enhance every part of the community having more resources. The second thing you have is because you're saving this money, it gets invested. So the economy gets bigger. Feldstein's estimated that at the end of their lifetime, the American economy will be $7 to $8 trillion a year bigger because of the momentum. This is what's happened in Chile. Chile now has such a huge savings pool, 72% of the Chilean economy is in that savings pool. That's how big it is. And they now allow Chileans to invest part of their savings overseas because the Chilean economy can't absorb all the savings. Now think about that compared to our current indebted mess. So it's a different model. So you'd be totally safe, your grandchildren are totally safe. It's a voluntary program, and the actuary for Social Security estimates that 95 to 97% of all young people would pick it because it is mathematically so much more powerful than the current system. So that's how we fix it, and that way you can relax, your children can relax, and your grandchildren can relax, okay? You're relaxed already. There we go. How about way over there? See the guy back there?
Mr. Speaker, I'm 30 years old and I got a son of two and one on the way. My concern is the financial future of our country, and I cannot vote for Ron Paul because of his dangerous foreign policy, but I think he is spot on with respect to how much and how aggressive he wants to be with respect to the amount we need to cut in spending. I understand he has a policy, he wants to cut $1 trillion over 10 years, which is just 1/15th of the $15 trillion in debt that we're in as a country. How much are you willing to cut, and what is your proposal for not just balancing the budget, because that's not enough? What is your proposal for actually trying to get on a path to cut our nation's debt?
Yeah, that's a very good question. By the way, I agree with you. I think that Ron Paul's, particularly his view on Israel and on Iran, are so dangerous that it makes it very hard to imagine him as president. But I think his critique of the Federal Reserve has a lot of strength to it, and I think that his critique of spending has a lot of strength to it. A couple things, and I say this from background of being the only person who has actually balanced the federal budget four times in a row in your lifetime, so I think I have some credentials for how to get this done. First, you want very dramatic economic growth, because if you have big enough economic growth, it eats up a lot of the problems just by the sheer momentum of scale and of how much people start making. Second, you want to control domestic discretionary spending. We've controlled it twice in my lifetime. In 1981, as a junior congressman, I participated in the first real cut in domestic discretionary spending since World War II. And in 1995, as Speaker, we had the second real cut. That is, not slowing down the rate of increase, but actually going down. So part of it is you have to cut spending. I believe if you apply what Strong America Now describes as Lean Six Sigma, that is, if you were to modernize the federal government so that it was as efficient as a modern company, I think we would save about $500 billion a year. That's $5 trillion over 10 years. I helped write a book called Stop Paying the Crooks, which looked at how bad the federal government is at managing payments. And our estimate was that in Medicare and Medicaid, there is somewhere between $70 and $120 billion a year being stolen. And when I say stolen, I mean a dentist who filed 982 procedures a day. I'm not talking about people who marginally fudge. I'm talking about stolen. And so we went to American Express, Visa, and MasterCard. We believe if you apply their anti-fraud mechanisms, you literally save between $60 and $110 billion a year. So there again, you can save over 10 years. And that doesn't count food stamps and student loans and other things. Just in Medicare and Medicaid, we think you can save something on the order of close to $1 trillion over 10 years. I would close down some of the departments. I mean, frankly, the Department of Energy has been an anti-energy department. So I would close it down. I would apply Lean Six Sigma. I don't know why we have a Department of Housing and Urban Development. I mean, I don't know why local housing authorities can't be required to run local housing authorities and cut out, 90% of the Washington regulations. These are the kind of things that just grow and grow. I would fundamentally overhaul the Washington offices. I would shrink the Department of Education dramatically. I would cut out the regulations, send the power back home to the states, and say, you got to have to figure out how to solve education. The federal government can't, and by the way, shouldn't. I don't want that level of power in Washington, D.C. So So my goal would be to try to get to it. It took us 3 years to balance the budget when I was Speaker. My goal would be to try, this is a much bigger mess. My goal would be to try to get to a balanced budget within 5 years and to be very aggressive about trying to get to a balanced budget within 5 years. And then you're right, you then have to run a surplus for enough years that with a combination of economic growth and control of spending, I think our goal should be to get our debt down to about 40% of GDP. And if you did that, you'd have paid off all the Chinese debt, and you'd have a very, very stable environment in terms of your fiscal situation. Behind me, okay? All right, where's the microphone? There's a guy right up here. He's coming to you right now. Speak again. I think they got it on now.
Good morning, Mr. Speaker.
Good morning.
As a 20-year Air Force veteran, two things I have in mind. One is, would you return us to a bare minimum of a don't ask, don't tell policy in the military? And two, what about repealing 100% of Barack Obama's executive orders?
Well, okay, the first one, yes. I would advocate going back to don't ask, don't tell. All of the combat services asked to stay with don't ask, don't tell, and they opposed what Obama was trying to do. The Army and the Marine Corps in particular were deeply opposed to it, and I think they were right. So I would go back to don't ask, don't tell. While it is a great line, and it is tempting, I don't want to say I'd repeal all of his executive orders until I knew what all of his executive orders are. I certainly have a bias in favor of repealing all of his executive orders, but I don't want to say yes. Here's what will happen. I'll say yes, I am for repealing all of his executive orders. One of our dear friends in the press will go back and find that executive order number 205 actually makes sense. And then they'll come running out and say, Gingrich wants to repeal X, whatever it is that actually makes sense. So let me just say, my bias is intensely in your direction, and I am committed to reviewing all of his executive orders, and a very substantial number of them will be repealed the first day. My goal is on inaugural day, about 2 hours after the inaugural address, to sign between 1 and 200 executive orders and really shift the government by the end of the very first day. So we will take reviewing his executive orders as a step in that direction. Okay? Very good. Now let me come back over this way. That's it. There's a guy right back there.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. One of the tragedies of the Clinton administration was the raping of the patent office and the rules for patents. This has cost America dearly because basically we're being ripped off both in medicines and in inventions where we are very successful in the past and actually is the foundation of our economy. Do you have some plans for doing something for the patent office? And I have one request.
Yes.
When we close this, will you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Okay, sure. I'd be glad to. I'd be honored to. All right, the Harvard person here. Where's our microphone?
Harvard. Here you go, Harvard.
Just got in. Early decision.
So in the first debate a while back, you stated that you would not increase taxes even if they agreed to decrease spending 10 times as much. How do you feel like you'll be able to do all these big plans when you're so unwilling to compromise?
Well, because I've done it twice before. In 1981, we helped pass the Reagan tax cut program by getting Democrats to decide to vote with us because we appealed to the American people, and the American people appealed to the country. They went to the Congress and said, you got to do this. When I was Speaker, when we passed welfare reform, we got 101 Democrats voted yes and 101 voted no. And it's because the country went to their members and said, you got to do this. So I think part of it is you have to work with people. Let me draw a distinction. I'm happy to cooperate. I'm not going to compromise. Compromise in Washington means sell out. And I'm not going to do that. And let me explain why I feel so strongly about this. In 1981, I helped pass the tax cuts. In 1982, President Reagan was talked into a tax increase because his senior staff didn't believe in the tax cuts. They were all Washington establishment types. Okay, I fought him that year, and I stood firm on Reaganism, which is no tax increase. He gave a speech which is the only speech he gave as president that failed. And people watched this speech, and Reagan explained why we had to raise taxes, and they all said, that was really weird. I wonder who wrote that speech, because it was so clearly not him. Okay? He wrote in his diary, this was the biggest single mistake of his administration. The Democrats had promised, if you'll raise taxes, we'll cut spending. They got all the taxes and none of the spending. And he said, I'll never do it again. When they tried to sell him on another tax increase, there's a famous story in the New York Times Magazine where Jim Baker's trying to sell him on another tax increase, and Reagan takes off his glasses and looks at him and says, Jim, if you believe what you just said, why are you in this administration? And Baker walked out and said to Dick Darmon, we're never talking about tax increases again while he's president, okay? 1990, I had campaigned very hard for Bush in 1988. And one of the keys to his winning, he was 19 points behind Dukakis in May. He won by six, it was a swing of 25 points. One of the keys was in the convention, he said, no new taxes. And he went on and said, read my lips, no new taxes. So he gets there, and several people, including Governor Sununu, sell him on the idea that it's really okay to break your word and raise taxes. And they came to me, and I said, no, I'm not going to do this. And in fact, you read Marlon Fitzwater's book, he says flatly, Bush's press secretary, I was the one guy who kept saying to them, this is a trap. The Democrats are suckering you in to accept a tax increase, to break your credibility, and to get more money. So I fought him. 1993, Bill Clinton comes in, he wants to raise taxes because the liberal Democrats tell him it. He didn't get a single Republican vote. It's one of the real reasons we won control of the House, is people were just fed up. So I start from a simple premise. I don't believe this country is undertaxed. I believe this country is overspent. One of the reasons... And I'm like Speaker O'Brien, I believe if you push hard enough, you'll get the spending cuts. But if you got guys over here who say, oh, I'm only going to vote for that if you raise taxes, you almost know for sure they're going to try to not give you the spending cuts. So I would go in a very aggressive program of saying, look, we're going to fight this out and do what we have to. But I would cooperate with Democrats. I would reach out. I'll give you just one quick example. Senator Webb and Senator Warner have a proposal to allow Virginia to develop oil and gas offshore. Half the royalties go to the feds, 37.5% to the Commonwealth of Virginia, 12.5% to infrastructure and land conservation. Now, these are two Democrats. I think the House Republicans ought to pass their bill without amendment. Just send it over and say, you know, here's a Democratic bill with bipartisan support. And make Senator Reid, the Democratic Majority Leader, confront, is he really going to bottle up two of his Democratic senators? Now, that's cooperation, because I happen to share the goal they want to get, okay? So that's the way I'd approach it. I would cooperate, I would try to get things done, but I would not be willing to compromise core values, because I think then you get on a slippery slope, and then Washington takes over again. We have had too many politicians who are reasonable, and they go to Washington and say, well, you got to be reasonable. And reasonable always means selling out. I have no interest in serving as a reasonable president who sells out the American people to appease the Washington establishment. It's exactly wrong. I want you... Go to one more. Okay, I'm told we're doing one more, and since he... Do you have one? Is there somebody over here who wants to be... She does, this lady right here with the sunflower dress.
Could you speak about your feelings on illegal immigration? I believe you felt sensitivity toward an illegal immigrant who may have worked hard, is working hard, is not on the dole, but what will the policy be? How will you decide?
That's good. No, I think this is a very important example of cooperating without compromising, in my judgment. First of all, I think there are a series of steps. I don't think you can pass comprehensive reform. I mean, Bush tried and failed. You know, Obama's tried and failed. When you put it all in one bill, it just crashes. It's too big. Step one, control the border. Control the border by January 1, 2014. How do you control the border? One, you pass a law that says we are waiving all federal regulations, control the border. So you don't go through EPA studies, you don't go through all this other stuff, you just do it. Two, there are 23,000 Department of Homeland Security employees in the Washington area. I'm prepared to move up to half of them to Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona to give you the manpower to control the border. Once you control the border, I would then, the next step I would take would be to make English the official language of government. We have 86 languages spoken in the Dade Community College. I think there are 80 languages in Manchester because it's a city that's been a refugee city. I think in Cook County, Chicago, there are over 200 languages. We need a single unifying language to bring us together as a people. It's clear English is the only language that can do that. Three, I would increase the requirement to become an American citizen in terms of learning American history so people actually learn what it means to be an American. Candidly, I would do the same thing for high school students. I think it'd be good for them to learn American history. Four, I would make legal visas easier. The current State Department process is a nightmare. We want tourists to come here. We want business people to come here. We want professors and students to come here. If they're going to come here legally and leave legally, we want to make it easy to do, not hard to do. Five, I would make it much easier to deport people who shouldn't be here. So if you're a member of an MS-13 El Salvadorian gang, which is in 65 cities, we should be able to get rid of you in 2 weeks. We shouldn't require 2 years of lawyering. You're not an American citizen. You don't deserve all those protections. Goodbye. Okay? Next, I would create a legal guest worker program, and I would outsource it to American Express, Visa, or MasterCard, because they know how to run it without fraud, and the federal government wouldn't have a hope of doing that. And so I would then, having created a legal guest worker program, dramatically increase the economic penalties for businesses who, in fact, are not obeying the law. Because remember, you don't get illegal workers without illegal employers. Now, having done that, now you get down to the hard part. There are 11 million people already here illegally. We just created a system where they're going to have a hard time getting a job because it's now you got a guest worker permit or you're an American citizen or you can't get hired. Most of them will go home and will apply for a guest worker permit from back home because they don't have really deep ties here. The question I raised, which seemed to be such a great shock to some of my colleagues who were running, was, what do you do about somebody who's been here 25 years? You know, they're a member of the community, they've been working hard, they've been paying their bills, they're married, they got kids, they got grandkids, they may belong to your church. Do you really think the American people are going to send the police in to take some grandfather out or grandmother out? You know, as a friend of mine said, a real case, he had a constituent who was a Marine serving in Afghanistan who was faced with his grandmother being deported. You know, I mean, you got to ask yourself, what do we do there? And here's my answer. You take the World War II Selective Service Board model, which is a local county board. You create a citizen review board. You can only apply if you've been here a long time, if you have genuine ties in the community, if you have been paying your bills and are clearly a member of the community in good standing, and if you can get an American family to sponsor you. Now, if you meet that standard, you go before the review board. If the review board thinks that you are a legitimate member of the community, you can get a certificate of residence, but not citizenship. But you're now here legally. You can get a job. You continue the rest of your life. If you then want to apply for citizenship, you have to go home long enough to apply. You don't have to stay there because you have a residency certificate. You have to go home, and you get in line back home behind everybody else who's legal. And that way you don't have anybody getting advantage. Now, one of my competitors said two things that I think are just plain, pardon the language, well, I'm not going to say it. Try and know, my mother used to teach me, if it's really dumb, don't say it. That's a lesson I find very hard to do. So let me try to use a different word. I don't quite understand what their thinking was. They said two things. One, they said, everybody has to go. Now, I can't wait for them to campaign in Florida. Okay, and try to go into Miami. on the battle cry, everybody must go. Okay? And I don't see how they think they're going to win a general election. Because that's clearly going to come across in the immigrant community as a sign you have no sense of humanity for people. But the second thing they said was, oh, this is creating a magnet. This will increase illegal immigration. Now, notice what I just described, all of you. Here's a program where we're controlling the border, creating a guest worker program, having overwhelming probably 9 or 9.5 million of the 11 million leave. You have to have been here, you know, 20 or 25 years and have a family and have a record of actually paying all your bills and have an American family sponsor you. What kind of a magnet is this? I mean, you're going to say to somebody in Mexico or Guatemala or China, you have two choices. You can apply for an American guest worker program and go legally and be legal and everything's fine, or you could sneak in and in 24 years you could become eligible for residency. I mean, this is just stupid. That's the word I was going to use earlier. I couldn't help myself. But you have to say to yourself, I mean, what kind of rationale, and you know what the reasoning is? Desire to hit the other candidate. That's all. I mean, since I said it, it must be a bad thing because otherwise it'd be a good thing. You know, I think that's foolish. I've often said, you know, Rick Perry has good ideas on the 10th Amendment. So I say, gosh, those are good ideas. He suggested that we start at zero with every foreign aid program and they have to earn their way back into the budget. That's a good idea. I don't mind saying if somebody has a good idea. That doesn't mean I think you should vote for him. He's a good guy, but, you know, not as good as me. I mean, so anyway, listen, what I'd like to do, this gentleman had a great idea. I want you to come up here and bring the flag. If they've been here that long, they've been paying taxes. In order to be eligible, they would have had to have been paying taxes. Oh, the sanctuary. That's one of the things I would do in the opening day is I would say no sanctuary cities get any federal funds. Period. Now, here you go. I want you to help lead us. I want all of you to join in now.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Now, which way do you want him to go? I want to be here. Which way do you want him to come?
We're going to come this way.
Okay, everybody come this way, and I'm going to see it. I'd love to see each one of you, including the folks up there. We'll all come this way, that way.
That's right.
Thank you.
Good. That's right. Nope.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
I know. Isn't amazing? Good to see you.
God bless.
Need your help Tuesday.
Okay.
Tell your friends.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. I was curious. You know, there must be a book on development.
There is. Several.
Because there was an interesting argument internally. You know, Patton was against bringing a new tank on because he didn't want to weaken the troops' morale. And
it shows up very late in the war.
Yeah.
This particular tank was at the Remagen.
They were over there that early?
Individual tank platoons were attached to armored divisions in March and February, March 1945. This one was actually at Remagen. This one was actually at Remagen.
Was it capable of standing up to the Panthers and the
Tigers?
Yes,
which is exactly why they wanted them. But as you say, the argument General Patton had is a good one. It was not good for morale.
Yeah. He
didn't have the necessity to do it.
Yeah, as well as to gradually do some.
This one actually runs.
How would it go against a King Tiger? Would it have to?
Well, it probably would not have done as well against the King Tiger, but the King Tiger mobility was such, it was almost road-bound.
Yeah,
so
you just maneuver and shoot it. So.
Exactly. Or blow up the road.
Was the Stalin comparable in being just too heavy?
I think the Stalin was a lot technologically inferior.
Yeah.
When I was an armorer.
Now, this didn't last very long, did it?
I mean, it was in Korea.
It was in Korea. Isn't it replaced by the 48?
Yes, that's correct. In fact, when I trained in the Army, we had M48s to train with.
Oh, yeah. No, I remember. I'm old enough. I mean, I grew up on 48s.
I graduated from BMI.
I remember when the 60 was coming in.
I remember that.
And that was the great revolution.
Yep. I graduated from VMI, and when I was an armor officer, we were always told that, you know, that we were going to be overrun with hordes of Russians, and that first round hits were important, and the M60 was a good tank.
It would have been wild. I helped Don Starry develop airland battle doctrine, and the whole question of how you contain the Soviets and the multiple echelons was an interesting problem, intellectually. And my dad, of course, he served in Orléans and Stuttgart in 57 to 60. Containing the Soviets was, we forget, the inner German border is gone, and all the stuff we did for a long time disappeared.
I'm going to allow myself one political comment with you, and that's when Obama was running last year, the one thing I complained about to everyone I knew is that he had never served a day in life in the uniform of his country.
Yeah.
And that's...
And had, no, and had no respect for it. So tell me the concept of the museum.
The museum actually has three components. It's meant to talk about the American World War II experience generally. We have a gallery on the far side that's just civilian, the home front, things that people experienced on the home front. And then there's a connecting tunnel here that sort of makes the transition. And in here we do military things. Now, because you're here, we pretty much gutted this exhibit. In fact, we have other tanks up there.
Oh, really?
And we're actually in the process of redoing the exhibits up here. In fact, the Navy exhibit is brand new, as in just recently.
Do you have a Sherman here, or what do you have?
We have an operational Sherman. We have an operational Stuart. We have an A-7 armored car. We have three half tracks.
Wow, you have quite a collection.
A command car.
Where are they at?
You want to go see them? I'll take you up there.
Where are they?
It's in the building up here. Right up.
Do we have to? Don't we have time? What's our schedule?
We have time, but we probably should get along. What are you thinking about?
Well, here's a whole building full of tanks.
He wants to see the tanks.
We do. Okay. We do have a meeting.
You want to do the press?
I'm sorry.
I'll wait.
If you don't mind, I think I'll walk up. Do I need to take this?
Stay behind you.
Okay.
One of the.
Do you want to? I'm going to find you. Steve or C-SPAN. Ask, do they want to go up and look at the tanks with us?
Okay.
Ray?
Take Mr. Gingrich up to see the other tanks. Make sure that the country keeps their word as to what they promised. They've already broken it a number of times and put on my uniform during NAM. I wore a uniform for 40
there's
years.
There's probably a way to make it a.
Where it's litigated
permanent.
Without having to make it cumbersome.
Yeah.
Just so that they don't keep diluting it.
Yeah, let me look at that. I think that's a good idea.
All right, thank you.
Getting the lights turned on. I'm not getting in your way. Go.
We've already heard a lot. What can you possibly do?
I'll ask you a question. You were very positive here today. You got a tremendous show of support. Let me start again. You were very positive here. You had a big outpouring of support. If you go after Mitt Romney tonight, might that not hurt your chances here?
Well, I'm not going to go after Mitt Romney. I may define the reality of a Reagan conservative and a Massachusetts moderate. I may describe the difference between cutting taxes and raising taxes, or being right to life and putting Planned Parenthood into Romney Care, but that's the most I'm going to do. I don't have to go. I don't know. I don't get this go after stuff. You don't need to do that. If your case is good, they used to say that Douglas was the best lawyer in Illinois with a bad case, and Lincoln was the best lawyer in Illinois with a good case. So the trick is try to find a good case. And if your case is good, you can be relaxed and happy. I was for Ronald Reagan in the 80s. Romney wasn't. That's not a hard thing to say. You can say it happily. I'm happy that I was for Ronald Reagan in the 80s.
You're not worried, then, Mr. Speaker, about coming across to viewers, maybe even in South Carolina, Florida, and beyond New Hampshire, as negative?
I don't think telling the truth in a happy, pleasant way comes across as negative. I mean, it may come across as the truth. It may feel... you have to ask Governor Romney how he feels about describing accurately his record.
Today you released a website, notromney.org. I mean, is that not negative?
Well, you want me to... How can I run for president and release a forromney.org? I mean, that would be goofy. I think notromney.org captured it.
And what else are you going to do with that website?
I don't know. You have to talk to people like RC who know all these things. I don't know any of these things.
How concerned are you about Mitt Romney winning New Hampshire, Iowa, and heading the polls in South Carolina?
Well, I'm very
really
concerned.
Having a lot of momentum going forward.
I'm very concerned. I think that we have to clarify. We have 2 weeks to clarify in South Carolina whether that he is a Massachusetts moderate and that he has a whole series of experiences and values that are the opposite of the South Carolina Republican Party. If we succeed in doing that, he won't win in South Carolina. If we don't succeed in doing that, he might win.
Can you explain your standing between you and Romney?
What?
I was wondering, Rick Santorum will be standing between you and Romney on the debate stage. I was wondering how you plan to differentiate yourself from him as the Romney alternative.
I don't. I intend to be the Reagan conservative alternative. I mean, it's not a me versus. I'm the Reagan conservative alternative. I started working with Ronald Reagan in 1974. I helped develop supply-side economics with Kemp and Laffer and others in the late 70s. I worked with Governor Reagan as candidate, President Reagan for 8 years. I was Speaker of the House. I helped develop the contract with America. I think I have a sufficiently positive, agenda. And three weeks ago, before all the negative advertising, I was the front runner. So why would I have to worry about doing anything except going back to what worked and then figure out how to get it to work past the negative advertising? That's all.
Do you think it was the negative ads that knocked you from that position?
How closely are you coordinating or speaking with the Santorum campaign? You
said none.
You
zero.
A junior partner.
Not at all.
No correspondence. No,
not at all.
About the patent office during the
Well, no, I said I'd look into it, but I don't know enough in detail about what he's discussing to jump into it, and I'm not going to jump in randomly.
Do you think you could have done better here in New Hampshire if more voters could have seen you at town meetings like this one?
Sure. I mean, just go talk to the voters who come to town meetings, and we get very, very high conversion rates at town meetings. So, and I'm delighted that C-SPAN covers several of them, because that means you have several hundred thousand extra people who see them.
Mr. Speaker, the leader of the Southern Baptist Convention said yesterday that he and other conservatives were reaching out to you and to Rick Perry to get you to drop out and throw your support behind Santorum. In fact, number one, have you been contacted?
Haven't contacted me.
And what would be your reaction to that?
Everyone's allowed to have an opinion.
Iowa, any preparations for tonight that's different?
Yeah. Well, no, standard preparation. Drink a Diet Coke, call Maggie and Robert, get their sophisticated coaching advice, focus in.
Be happy and pleasant.
Yeah, slower, smile, shorter, clearer.
Are you watching any movies?
Do you consult with anybody about what you're going to talk about? Or
yeah, I talk to Maggie and Robert.
Who?
Maggie and Robert.
That's it?
Yes. When you have, look, how many debates do people think I won? Okay, you got two debate coaches with a winning streak like theirs. What are you going to do,
They're like a Bill Belichick debate coach.
That's right. I mean, I could go to some of these guys, but why would you when you had Maggie and Robert?
Mr. Gingrich, if you're some part of Northern Pass, the local communities that will be affected could get up to $25 million annually in tax revenue. Some of them might, some people in those communities might say would rather get $1 million in tax revenue than see that kind of revenue to the state. Can you speak to that argument?
Sure. I think where it would end up going directly through the community, they'd own the right of way instead of the state, and they'd be able to get the revenue. It'd be a question of who owns the right of way. In some places, it would be a city street or something. But it allows you to avoid the whole problem of having eminent domain over private property, and it allows you to avoid the danger of ruining the tourist industry and ruining the beauty of northern New Hampshire. So virtually everybody I've talked to in the north country has said they really prefer this solution, and it's one I think that's really worth exploring. Thank you all very, very much.